My favorite way to start.
Hey. Was that a cough?
It was. I think I got Rona.
That's too bad.
Shit, don't joke about that, Josh.
You're jinxing yourself.
I think I'm...
You're jinxing our listeners, and you're jinxing me.
You put yourself last.
If... I always put myself after my listeners and you. That's the collective. The I comes last in collective. Wait, there's no I in collective? No, there is an I in collective. Oh shit.
I was just thinking of I was thinking of other vowels. But yeah.
I think we should protest the I in collective. It's time to get rid of that I.
It's real stain.
Yeah, so what can you do?
I can double fist a glass of water and a glass of cocktail.
Why are they called cocktails?
I don't know, Jerry Seinfeld. Why are they called cocktails?
I'm just asking. I don't know.
What's the deal with calling these drinks cocktails? There's no cock. There's no tail.
Oh, we're funny.
Man. Where are we at in like irony culture of how hack it is to even do ironic mocking Seinfeld jokes? I don't know where we are. Yeah. I think we're probably what we just did was not cool.
No, no, I don't think so. I mean, I often feel like I'm a bit too young for Seinfeld, and I'm pretty damn old. I'm at least older than 34, which has been clarified in the podcast before.
I don't know. I watched it growing up as a kid, actually.
I guess I was too busy watching Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, which was way more action-packed than Seinfeld.
Okay, Seinfeld ended in, like, probably 98 or something. That was my first year of high school. You're still watching Ninja Turtles?
Oh, no. I was that kid in high school that was too cool for TV. I made fun of people for watching TV.
Yeah.
There were books. There were other things to do in my time.
I guess by the time Seinfeld was ending, I was probably in that same camp in a way, but I don't know. Funny show. I'm sure if we rewatched it, we could find all kinds of unwoke things about it and things to hate about it. I don't know.
I'm sure I've seen more of it than I remember. The only episodes that stick out in my mind is the episode where they're playing Risk on the bus, just because the board game Risk, while I loved as a kid, is kind of a terrible board game. And not as bad as Monopoly, but it's just terrible. And the Chinese restaurant episode, which I think might be the most famous Seinfeld episode.
It's a pretty classic one, yeah. I like that Risk thing when he's on the subway with it and he's trying desperately to keep all the pieces in the correct place.
No, I remember it being hilarious, at least at the time.
Walk down memory lane.
Would you equate
TV.
Yourself as a Chandler or a Kramer? Wait, that's not the same show, is it?
I always liked George the best, and
he's the Wally guy.
There is no Chandler. That's Friends.
Friends, the incredibly white show.
I never watched
all
Friends.
All of New York is white, apparently.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone can afford luxury apartments in the 90s.
Yeah, that's another hack joke that's also been like revitalized as a like ironic hack joke, but I think is now just hack again. Like, what's the deal with these characters in TV having these like massive apartments in New York? It makes no sense.
Are you calling me a hack for making hack jokes?
No,
I'm
just... You
want to die?
I'm just trying to...
Chugale.
I'm just trying to, like, get a sense of where it's at. Because it's stuff that... It interests me how that stuff changes without any real, like... there's no, like, committee decision. Like, it's just organically, you know... You see which way the winds are blowing culturally.
I miss the time in TV when every apartment was the same apartment because NBC only had one studio and they just had to use that same damn apartment set for every show.
Is that what they did? I guess I believe that. Yeah.
I really don't know if they did that. Was the first TV apartment I Love Lucy? The first, like, New York TV apartment? Probably not, but
no
in
idea.
In my head, it was probably that. And I feel like that apartment was used on more than one, like, that apartment set was used on one of the more than one TV show, but I have no proof of that. Like, I'm basically just making this up.
I mean, I'm sure it's happened where, like, especially if a show ends, they just, like, all right, use this set because it's cheaper than building a whole new one and, like, maybe modify it. But, I think... I think everything we just said is quite boring.
He walked out in the gray light and stood and he saw for a brief moment the absolute truth of the world. The cold, relentless circling of the intestate earth. Darkness implacable. The blind dogs of the sun in their running. The crushing black vacuum of the universe. And somewhere 200 animals trembling like ground foxes in their cover. Borrowed time and borrowed world and borrowed eyes with which to sorrow it. And lo, for the earth was empty of form, and void, and darkness was all over the face of the deep, and we said, look at that fucker dance.
Welcome to Heat Death of the Universe, coming to you from Seoul, South Korea. Hard time stamp, September 13th, 2020. The time is 3:52 p.m. on a Sunday, Korea Standard Time. Now that that important news is out of the way, what are we up to today, Jason? Are we going to be as lighthearted as last time?
I hope to keep our show light, friend, and family friendly. This is the type of show you sit down in front of your fireplace with Timmy and Susie. When you put on the podcast on your external radio.
All right, pipe down, children. We're about to learn about the Flint water crisis from two foul-mouthed pieces of shit.
I think that it is the most appropriate family activity a family could decide to activitize. Is that even a word?
I don't think so.
Well, it is now. As you sit down by your fireplace with a nice Yule log kindling, enjoy the headlines that have came to us over the past 48 hours. Headlines vast and unique. Headlines that could change your very understanding of reality. Headlines that could expand the porridge that you call your brain. And perhaps bring you and your loved ones closer together as we bundle our way through
the headlines.
The news.
It's another edition of copyright pending Clickbait Roulette. So, we didn't decide this beforehand, but who should read a headline first? What do you think, Jason? You choose.
I'll go first.
Okay.
My first headline is the unexpected side effects of tall buildings.
Wow. Well, I regret to inform you, if I'm gonna be candid, as I always should be on the podcast, the unexpected side effects of tall buildings, considering that I've been listening to 4 episodes over the last like 2 days of TrueAnon, which is focused entirely on 9/11 trutherism. And because, you know, 9/11 was 2 days ago.
Was it?
Yeah. It's the 13th. And the first thing that popped into my head was that one unexpected side effect of tall buildings is that, you know, kaboom. Sorry. Starting off. This is the family-friendly podcast you're talking about.
Yeah. I know what you mean by kaboom, though.
Oh, go ahead.
I mean, you just haven't lived until you've watched a big, like, fireworks show from a tall building.
Oh, yeah, that's what I'm talking
just
about.
Just right, line in sight, like the fireworks are right in front of you. Oh, it's amazing. I want to do it one day.
Yeah, I guess that could also be an unexpected side effect. I was thinking more about, you know, airplanes and...
Yeah, airplanes flying by and you're, like, really, like... work out the details and see them very clearly as they pass the building safely.
Another unexpected side effect of tall buildings, they are known to collapse at free fall because jet fuel can't melt steel beams. Okay,
hey,
off of all that.
That's kind of neat, though. And it's cheaper than going to a carnival.
Yeah, these are all very valid theories about what this headline could mean. I don't know if I can even be serious about this one. Let me think for a second. Because a side effect usually implies a negative thing, right? I don't know. Like, usually I associate that with, like medical warnings. Like, side effects include death, diarrhea, dry mouth, you know, so on. So it's probably not a good thing. I don't know. I mean, I guess the unexpected side effect of making the other buildings feel... like betas, feeling really cucked by the big boys.
I have noticed that the 6-7 building always looks a bit more grim and sad ever since they built Lotte Tower.
63 building?
Oh, is it the 63 building?
Yeah.
I always pretend it has an extra 4 floors.
Always? You always. Do this every day?
And it's the first time I've really thought about how sad it looks since they built the Lotte Tower, or as I like to call it, the Eye of Sauron.
It does kind of look like that, doesn't it? Yeah. This is another edition of Soul Building Talk. I really don't know. I think maybe we should just jump into this one and see what the real deal is behind this facade.
You want me to let you know what the nasty side effect is?
This veil of a headline. Yeah, go ahead.
It may not surprise you. But this
I'm gonna click on it too. But go ahead.
Side effect that you may have never expected from tall buildings is perhaps they give you headaches.
Like from like altitude sickness or something.
No, you would think that's not why. It's because as humans, we evolved to like live on the ground and to experience earth-sized things, but buildings have reached such giant heights that looking up to them is almost unnatural for our brains and disorienting, and the unnatural, like, just heights they reach give you headaches.
Really? I haven't pulled up the article yet. Is that for real?
Really? Because the repetitive patterns of urban architecture break the rule of nature, it is more difficult for the human brain to process them efficiently, and because urban landscapes are not as easy to process, they are less comfortable to look at. Some patterns, such as the stripes on doormats, carpets, and escalator stairs, can trigger headaches and even epileptic seizures.
Really?
They're just unnatural.
I mean, that's actually kind of interesting.
It is interesting.
I also kind of am skeptical in a weird way, too. I don't know why. Because, like, I'm looking at all these pictures here on the article, and I kind of like the sort of awestruck feeling of just, like, look how big it is.
Me too.
They're kind of, like, kind of beautiful, like even the ones that like symbolize all kinds of evil shit. Like
all of these look better than the pictures I take of buildings.
Yeah, they look like almost professional, you might say.
CNN has never once used one of my pictures, by the way.
And you've never once submitted?
No, I can't say I have. I just thought they like scoured the internet and like grabbed images and put them on there.
I wonder where the first picture is from, the one at the very top, like before any of the writing. It reminds me of a lot of images I've seen that are taken like in like Beijing or like other huge cities too. In China, where they're like there's similar kind of buildings in Korea for sure, but I think it's even more sprawling in like I don't know Shanghai or Beijing. But even those pictures, which I know like are kind of depressing if you think about like what's going on inside each of those little like cubicles, but like taken as like a landscape, there's something kind of visually interesting, appealing about it. Anyway, that was a way better reveal than I was expecting.
The cause of the headaches, I mean, are from it being like not similar to nature, but I suppose when our brains like see things that aren't like something we've evolved to see, they start to use more oxygen, and headaches tend to be associated with excess oxygen usage.
But then you'd think that would be happening all the time. Like I'm looking around where we are right now, this really high-tech studio that we're in, and I see like an electric kettle, I see a microwave, I see a refrigerator, I see a chair, I see a laptop. None of these things are like mimic anything from nature, and I'm feeling fine.
I'm feeling all right.
So
I mean,
I'm a little skeptical of this, but I find it interesting. But I think we should move on to the next one.
Let's go to the next one.
So I will feed you a headline, good sir.
Okay.
4 insane things just happened to Tesla.
Who's Tesla?
Nikola Tesla. Well, I assume this is probably not about him, but you can guess how you want.
Well, if it's Nikola Tesla, we know he's dead. So he's been resurrected as an AI to finally speak his piece about Edison, I guess. Though.
Yeah, it would be Edison. They were, you know, rivals and
best friends.
Edison was a real piece of shit to him.
That's at least what Reddit taught me for a while.
What, that they were best friends?
No, they were real pieces of shit to each other. One of them made.
I think more that. I almost said Einstein, then I almost said Eisenhower. I mean Edison.
Not the same time.
Yeah. Edison was the real piece of shit though in that equation, as far as I know. But anyway, go on.
The main thing I know is one invented alternating current or AC, and the other one did the direct current stuff, which was DC, and the one Tesla made was technically better than the one Edison made, but none of it fucking matters, really.
And Edison was like this tyrant who just stole ideas and patented them before anyone else could. And
Tesla was definitely like the business manager of the two. I think, not Tesla, I mean Edison was.
He was
like, I have a corporation. I put my name on everything. Everything my corporation
that
makes
sounds
is
like
mine.
That sounds like a guy that everybody hates these days.
Oh, you mean, which one? There's a lot of them, come to think of it.
I mean, who puts slapped their name on all kinds of buildings and products and shit? Trump.
Oh, I thought you were talking about Elon Musk.
Oh, well, yeah.
Oh, could this Tesla be talking about the cars?
I was going to say that's probably what it's about, but okay, I mean, that's the whole thing about these headlines. Like, they could be, they're misleading, you know?
I know the four insane things that just happened to Tesla. Insane thing number one, they invented a flying car.
Yeah, that happened to them. Go on.
Insane thing number two, it just happened to Tesla. It burned to the ground in the California wildfires, which is actually very sad. The wildfires, not Tesla burning.
Yeah.
They went bankrupt, but the government decided to give them a giant bailout for kicks. Because why not? That didn't happen. Actually, I really don't know what foreign things happened. Four insane things happen to them. I imagine they're all good things. I don't know why. I just think they're all going to be like things that are in Elon Musk's favor, because everything seems to go in that guy's favor for whatever fucking reason.
Shall we uncover the mystery?
Yeah, let me know. Let me know what's up with Tesla. I hope it's about Nikolai.
You should open it up too, because I didn't actually really read this one in advance like I should have. Right. And you know more about this stuff than I do. It is definitely not about the man, Tesla. It is, as you predicted, about the company. I think basically the gist of it is that they lost a bunch of money, but like, it's like fucking boo-hoo. He still has like billions of dollars, you know. So they had like one of their worst. Okay, number one, stock slump. They were one of the best performing stocks this year, but it had its worst trading day since its entire history. So
21% slide. That's, yeah,
pretty big. It is. I saw people cheering on the, should I plug this? The Chapo Trap House shit posting group on Facebook. People were like gleefully in
I need to make an aside.
Yeah.
We do not endorse Facebook, but shit posting groups are okay.
Yeah.
If you want to join those, go for it.
It's the only thing I'm using that website for at the moment. But the consensus was that, yeah, like they lost a bunch of money, and there's like pictures of Elon Musk looking kind of sad and whatever, and I don't know. Your ideas were way more interesting than the real story. I mean, just to round it out, their second insane thing was more competition, which, I don't know, I thought that was the whole point of laissez-faire capitalism, whatever. No, they're saying it's insane and bad and unusual. Competition, dear God. Yeah, more boring. This is like in the business section of CNN.
Huh.
Maybe I should stay away from that. Basically, yeah, they lost a bunch of money, but it really doesn't make a huge dent in the overall company, and it definitely doesn't really hurt the individual man, Mr. Musk.
It's amazing to me that Tesla is worth more than Toyota, Disney, and Coca-Cola.
Oh, really?
That's what the last bit where it says the S&P 500 snub. Despite losing about $100 billion in market cap since then, Tesla is still worth more than Toyota, Disney, and Coca-Cola.
Combined or like individually?
Individually, but still individually, that's nuts. Because
I would assume Disney is more powerful than Tesla.
Like, I don't think of Toyota as giant, but I know it is. But Disney and Coca-Cola as an American, like those are big companies.
That's
right?
That's shocking to me because Disney is like gobbling up everything in like the entertainment business. But I mean, I guess, I don't know, the last 6 months have been pretty bad for like anyone in the entertainment business.
That's true. That's very true.
I don't know. We're not business guys.
I bet Tesla wouldn't be having these problems now had Elon Musk fixed the water crisis that he promised to fix.
Oh, right. That fucking douchebag. Did we mention that on the episode? I don't remember.
I'm pretty sure we did.
I think we just talked about it like outside of it. But
he made a promise, much like many other people made promises, not to rest until he fixed the crisis. Yada yada yada.
He said, any home that is still having water problems, I will personally fix your problem. So it was kind of like hit up my DMs kind of thing.
Yeah, I mean, he's always going for that. I'm Tony Stark. I'm Iron Man. I'm a genius, capitalist, entrepreneur, inventor that can fix all the world's problems.
Was Tony Stark like a philanthropist, though, in the comics? I mean,
in the movies.
I thought he was like a real asshole in the comics.
I think in the comics, I've read a few, but it's been a while. I read, there's a famous series where he's like getting over alcoholism. I think that's the one that people always say, like, if you're like in one of those movies where you're reading like the top 500 best graphic novels of all time. I know the, what's the series where Tony is going through alcoholism is always highly regarded. And it was really good, but it's been a while since I've read it, so.
Well, you look that up. I'm going to pick out another.
Let's choose another one.
Headline here.
Demon in a Bottle. That's right. I should have known that. Which were issues 120 to 128 in the 1979 issues of Iron Man by Marvel Comics.
I hope. Well, I don't know if I hope this, but.
I don't.
I was going to say I hope we have some comic book fans listening, but. Do I?
I mean,
actually, I'm just kidding.
Fine
I don't
with comics.
No, me too. I'm making a dumb joke. It's not my bag. I don't know anything about it.
Elon Musk does not have a problem with alcoholism. Like,
fuck that guy. I don't give a shit about him.
I mean, but he's one of the few people that could completely afford any type of problem.
I'm gonna plug another podcast just for the sake of talking about Elon Musk. Behind the Bastards, that one I've recommended to you before. I think you listened a little bit. They did like at least a two, maybe even three parter on Elon Musk, and the guy who does all the research and is the host, can't remember his name at the moment. I want to say Robert Evans. He goes like super deep dive research on all his episodes, and yeah, you learn a lot of fucked up weird shit about Elon Musk, and I recommend listening to that if anyone's interested in it.
I have a pet asshole theory that everyone in tech is autistic, but I feel bad saying that because I know you're not supposed to say that about people.
Yeah, I mean, it's not that like crazy of a theory. I mean, I'm sure it's not everybody, but all right, let's go to the next one. So now you're gonna feed me one, right? Yeah.
I will feed you one. From a smally fish to a dangling raccoon.
From a smiley fish to a dangling raccoon. I gotta repeat that because it's not making much sense in my brain right now.
So what do you think this could mean?
I don't know. that's a little bit of the problem with the roulette is that some of these are really like confounding and it takes you a second to take it in. But okay. Man, I think this is the weirdest one we've ever done, like out of the three times we've done this, but okay, all I think of when I think of a smiley fish, I just keep thinking of the fucking, what was it called? The Billy Bass?
Oh, the Billy Bass singing wall ornament?
Yeah, the singing fish.
My grandfather had one of those. He fucking loved that thing.
Man, a lot of people love that thing. I bet the guy who made that is like at least a multimillionaire now.
I'm sure he's more than that. If he's still alive, he might be dead now. That thing's pretty old.
Is it? By old, you mean like from like the 90s?
Yeah, okay. From the 90s. The 90s was nearly 25 years ago.
Right? I know, but sometimes old can mean, you know, we're old, or it can mean, you know, did you know Billy Bass was really invented at the turn of the century?
That thing's really old. Did you know Billy Bass was invented by Nikola Tesla? One of the few inventions Thomas Edison did not steal.
That's the only one he didn't get his hands on. I just pictured insane Nikola Tesla petting his Billy Bass as it sings in his like empty house. You know, like about some of the eccentricities of Tesla, okay. Right? Like, you know, nobody's like eating his diet.
No, what did he eat?
He basically because like his whole thing was like basically he was like anorexic, but like not, he didn't have like body dysmorphia. He didn't. The reason he barely ate was like he thought that it gave him energy, which it kind of does.
Fasting does. There's some research behind, like, but there's fasting and hitting this place.
That's true. Like, but that's in like the short term, like intermittent fasting. Like, his thing was like long. I think it was just a thing where he was so busy working that his mind would never drift to like, I have to eat.
Such a genius stereotype. I'm always thinking, I'm always busy, I'm always creating. I don't have time for basic human necessities like food or sleep.
Yeah, I mean, and that was the other thing, is sleep, is he barely slept either. He barely ate and barely slept, like as like a purposeful regimen. Like it was like a purposeful thing though on his part. I read an article about it once before, but anyway.
This is a bit random, but on that topic, in the 90s, I remember, or probably even before the 90s, but it seemed to be like a really big thing for people not to sleep. Like, you're a really hard worker if you could like work on like 4 hours or working on like 3 hours of sleep. Like, even your favorite president, Bill Clinton, was really big into not sleeping, because sleep is for the weak and tomorrow you'll be strong sort of deal. But nowadays, sleep has become embraced. Like, you read like any sort of life improvement articles or life hacks, and they're always like, 8 hours of sleep, it'll do you fucking wonderful.
I feel
your body
like
good.
I feel like people have been saying that forever, though. I mean, are you talking about like the sort of like the Wall Street culture of the 80s?
The cult of work in the 80s and 90s.
Yeah, but that wasn't like. That wasn't like
normal people.
Normal accepted, like, because I always grew up with the 8 hours. You know, get your 8 hours.
It's if I ever count myself lucky, I feel we're lucky that Wall Street was never completely normalized, like their entire culture. So maybe the world would be a bit more fun if everyone was doing lines of cocaine off of bathroom saws.
You can do that without like destroying the world with your horrible job. But anyway,
that's true, but it's less fun.
You know, I never saw the movie Wall Street, but I did. Okay, when I taught at the mental health facility, the first one that I taught at, not taught, sorry, I just worked there. I would sometimes take the kids to go see movies, like on the weekends. And one time, because sometimes they would just like, they'd give me some money and be like, get these kids out of here, basically. And anyway, we watched some of the dumbest movies just because we would watch anything that was playing at like the time that we needed to watch it at. And we went and saw Wall Street, Wall Street 2, like Wall Street Never Sleeps, I think is what it's called.
There's a second Wall Street movie?
Yeah.
Wow. I never saw the first one either.
I didn't either, but like, the second one had like Shia LaBeouf. Is that how you say his last name?
I think so.
LaBeouf, whatever.
His video project he started in 2016 when Trump was elected.
You Will Not Divide Us. Yeah. We're really digressing here, but I kind of like that. I think he gets kind of a bad rap.
I think he's an okay person.
He's a good actor. I'll at least give him that. Now that he stopped doing all those dumb movies like Transformers and shit. But anyway, the movie, I believe this, the subtitle of the movie was like Money Never Sleeps or something like that. And I fucking passed out like immediately in the theater watching that movie when I was supposed to be keeping an eye on these like really troubled kids who were like always constantly like just trying to sneak out of the movie theater to like smoke cigarettes and weed and stuff. And anyway, I just remember like hating that movie because I was just like in and out of consciousness, and like I also really hated that job. But we got really far away from Billy Bass, which was also just the beginning of me trying to understand this headline.
You figured out Billy Bass is the smallie fish, but who is the dangling raccoon?
Yeah, that's the really, really confounding part to me. And I know the smiley fish is not going to be Billy Bass, but that's my best guess. The dangling raccoon. I have no fucking idea, but I, just thinking again about like anecdotal stuff. Have you ever heard a raccoon scream?
No, but I've heard a fox scream.
It might be similarly disturbing. It sounds like a woman being murdered to death.
Yeah, that's what a fox
scream sounds like. I guess murdered to death. Stabbed to death or something.
That's exactly what a fox screaming sounds like.
It's really unnerving. It's really unnerving. The first time I heard the raccoon, I assumed they were raccoons. And my friend kept saying, oh, that's just the raccoons. But they kept happening. I was like, I think we should call the police. Like, and this was like in the suburbs where, like, you know, that kind of thing would be far less likely to happen. But still, I was like, that can't be an animal. Like, it sounds so human and so terrifying. So I'm going to say Billy Bass went on a murderous rampage. Let's see what the real deal is.
All right. You want me to do the reveal?
I'm going to reveal it to myself as well.
Okay.
But go ahead, tell me.
The reveal is sadly not about Nikola Tesla's last moments of creating a artificially intelligent Billy Bass that eventually started
Do you think Billy Bass is an AI?
serial murdering raccoons by dangling them from trees. This is actually just the Comedy Wildlife Photography Awards.
I'm going to scroll down now. All right. First of all, that smiling fish is very upsetting to look at.
It's a little creepy.
It's very creepy.
I didn't know fish could have teeth like that.
That might be the episode art, or I'm at least going to link to the page. Okay, so these are separate. Before I scroll down, I thought it was going to be a picture of a smiling fish being... Oh, wait, that wouldn't make sense. I thought it would be like a raccoon dangling a smiling fish, but... Now, these are separate pictures. Oh, and there's a bunch of other weird ones. I think I've heard of these before, the wildlife, like silly nature photos of animals, yeah.
I think it's something like...
The raccoon one is kind of funny, I guess. Yeah. I'll give it... It's.
I've heard somewhere like something like... Oh, I'll fuck the number up. I'm going to say between 25 to 50% of all wildlife on Earth has died in the past like 10 years.
25%?
It's a very large number.
Yeah, goddamn.
It's always shocking.
It's probably... But a huge percentage of that is in the ocean. But I'm that's just a guess, a hunch. All right, so it was actually a lighthearted story about these Comedy Wildlife Photography Awards, and there were 44 photos in the competition.
Looks like. Gotta keep it light. Gotta keep it simple.
And the dangling raccoon is it's a raccoon going into like a hole in a tree, and just his legs and tail are sticking out. And I guess it looks kind of funny. Moving on. Okay, here you go. I got one for you. FBI investigating report of guy in jetpack.
Oh, this is easy. As we learned earlier this week, Tesla was hit hard by the stock market. They're bleeding money, and this is definitely a publicity stunt by Elon Musk because he's finally decided to build his own Iron Man suit and fly around in a jetpack and pretend to be a superhero. I mean, he's probably going to fly it all the way to Flint and fix the water supply first, and then he might, like, you know, pay some kids to get stuck in a cave so he can fly down into a cave and, like, carry them out one by one.
They put out the fires in California, too.
I imagine so. It's sad that the FBI is not into his publicity stunt, but you can't just go around flying a jetpack wherever you willy-nilly please.
Have you ever seen like videos on YouTube or whatever of like actual jetpacks?
I have. I even saw someone who made a jetpack out of Coca-Cola 2-liter bottles.
What the fuck? Just that?
Yeah, just like used the fizz from the Coca-Cola bottles and a device he made to open them all at the same time to lift himself off the ground.
Oh, seriously? Yeah. How high did he get, would you say?
Like 4 feet. Not like super high. But
that's still more, something.
More than I would have expected.
Yeah.
Like, that's being propelled by like soda.
I'd say that's maybe the best use of Coca-Cola ever. Maybe.
No, it's great for watering your plants.
Right. Also, you suggested that Flint should just replace their water with Coke Zero last week. Or whatever. Whenever that was. 3 days ago. Final guess. Elon Musk is doing an Iron Man thing.
I think it's a publicity stunt to put Tesla back at number one.
Okay, let's take a look. I just realized that I didn't follow my own sort of instructions or whatever about going and reading these things first. So here we go, cold read. FBI investigating report of guy in jetpack flying 3,000 feet in the air at LAX. Quote, only in LA.
So I'm not wrong. They're not sure who this guy is. Well, he's on Elon Musk.
Also, hang on. You're right. They don't know who it is. No one has come forward to take the credit for the stunt. Why would they? The FBI is investigating it.
Want to give them an award to be like, hey.
Yeah, the FBI's got an award for best jetpacking.
It's been a long time since we've had to deal with a rocketeer in these parts.
That's a movie I haven't seen since I was very young and I don't remember anything about.
I watched it recently.
Is it good?
It is good.
Really?
I'd recommend it. I mean, I think it holds up better than a lot of movies from that time period.
You know, that movie always makes me think of the movie Inner Space. Do you remember Inner Space?
I do remember Inner Space.
I thought Inner Space was great as a kid. I think they might have come out around the same time. That's why I think of them together. Anyway, let's see what this is really about beyond the headline. The FBI is investigating a report from airline pilots that a person was seen flying in a jetpack some 3,000 feet above LAX Sunday evening. The Federal Aviation Administration said two airline flight crews reported seeing what appeared to be, quote, someone in a jetpack as they were on their final approaches to LAX. Okay, so some commercial flights saw this happen. Now this is kind of funny. Fox 11 Los Angeles obtained recordings of communications between the aircraft and the tower. Tower, American 1997, we just passed a guy in a jetpack, a pilot said. American 1997, okay, thank you. Were they off to your left side or your right side? Is this how these people we pay to, like, keep us from crashing into each other really, like, oh, I don't know.
Communicate? Sure.
You know, actually, I have a really, like...
How else would they communicate?
It just seems so casual, I guess, but that's they're being professional, though. But that's what's funny about it to me, is they're not being like, what the fuck, a guy in a jetpack? They're just like, okay, was the jetpack to your right or left? I actually have a deep respect for... fuck, what do you call them? The people who...
Aircraft controllers?
Yeah, the aircraft controllers. Because, man, that seems like It seems like kind of a hard job with a lot of responsibility on your hands. Like, yeah, you fuck up just a little bit, and, like, my God, the consequences. But,
I knew a guy who did that, but he was laid off at some point during his career because of things and layoffs and... cut back some funds.
That was one of Reagan's big legacy things, was like
layoffs.
Well, specifically the air traffic controller like union. Like, he just completely, like, left them out to dry or fucked them over. I don't remember the details exactly.
And but oddly enough, not that it matters all that much, but that's one of those jobs that losing the union also generally really hurts military people, because it's a job that often people who leave the military can, or at least the Air Force can do. Doesn't matter. I'm just trying to say that the government often tries to fuck over people who join the military, which is probably a good reason not to join the military. Your government does not have your back. And why sign up to carry a gun?
Very true. And there's another story that I could go into, but I'm not. But you saw the thing about the veteran getting 5 years prison time for medical marijuana?
Well, he deserved it. Marijuana is illegal federally. It doesn't matter if it's legal in states or not. You're breaking the law.
It was actually because he crossed state lines, and he was in a state where it's not legal, and he got really fucked over. But anyway, that's for another day, I guess.
Everyone knows you shouldn't cross lines.
And, all right, I said I wasn't going to talk about it, but I will just summarize the worst parts about it, because it really pissed me off today to read it. The guy has, like, serious, like, cognitive disabilities now because of injuries sustained in the battlefield, basically. Sure. And he has, like, extreme PTSD, and the cops purposely split him. He was with his wife at the time when they got arrested, and they were kept in jail for, like, 6 days, which is also unusual for a fucking marijuana offense. And bunch of other technical shit where the judge tried to fuck them over, so they had to, like, rush back to whatever state it was. I want to say Alabama. Anyway, and the wife was like, listen, he's, like, cognitively impaired, and he needs me or, like, legal counsel or someone with him if you're going to question him. And they were like, fuck you. Oh, also, take a guess what race this guy was, by the way. So they put this guy who doesn't really know how to think through things very clearly, and the way they got him to just sign a plea deal to spend 5 years in jail for possession of a small amount of medical marijuana was, well, if you don't sign this, we're going to charge your wife for the same thing, and your wife will get the same, you know, punishment as you. And he was like, well, I don't want that to happen to my wife. So he just fucking signed it away, and now that guy's not getting out of jail for 5 years.
Yeah, that's super fucked.
It's so disgusting,
the
man.
The way plea deals work is actually really fucked.
But I don't even know how that can hold up in court if he's like...
Well, no, once you sign a plea deal, you're basically forfeiting your right to go to court, and that's why I say they're fucked, because a lot of times they get, like, pressed on people to be like, just do this, it'll make everything easier, and it gets the charge through, and you're like... just go ahead and say, no, I don't need to go to court. I don't need to deal with this. And it's usually not in your favor.
But what if what if he had Down syndrome? Like, couldn't that be thrown out?
Probably.
I don't know. Anyway, I forgot what we're even talking about now.
The system is abusive to people, and it'll continue to be.
Oh, and that's the thing, of course, about, like, this case is, like, there are millions and millions of these cases that have happened and will continue to happen, but this one in particular is, like, kind of getting spread around the internet recently. But jetpacks, wait, that's what we're talking about still, right?
I'm pretty sure we're talking about jetpacks. I would love to have a jetpack. Personally, I think having a jetpack would be pretty neat.
I mean, the article is basically just going through these pilot reports of citing it. That's it. And the FBI is opened an official investigation, and there's no fucking way they're gonna find this cool guy.
I already solved the case.
Oh, right. You should call up the FBI, and maybe there's a reward.
Well, maybe I will tonight. Maybe I will tonight.
All right, we should go into the next one, huh?
Yeah, let's do it. So here's a nice one for you. Woman who sawed off her hand found guilty of fraud.
Let's see. Woman who sawed off her hand found guilty of fraud. Was the fraud... having a prosthetic hand?
No. Not at all.
I mean, it seems fraudulent. If you're trying to pass off having a real hand when it's just fake, like, you're fucking fraud. Wow, you grabbed some good ones this week, man. I gotta hand it to you.
I am looking for the hard hitting news.
No, these are like really genuinely stumping me, which is good, which is what we want in the clickbait roulette. Shit. And also, I did pick these out of a larger pool of headlines. All transparency for the listeners, but I still have not seen what the actual headline and real article are. Did she saw off her own hand as a way of escaping from police custody, like to get out of handcuffs?
Oh, no way. She sawed off her hand just to saw it off.
Oh, just for kicks.
Yeah, I mean, she just did it because she's like, that's the day I'll wake up and saw off my hand. I
was curious to see what would happen.
I won't lie. Like, every time I've drove over a bridge, I thought, what would happen if I just drove my car off this bridge? I'd probably survive, right?
That's probably like an understandable, weird impulse that almost everyone has had in a way. Like, or when you're standing on a high, like from like a high vantage point.
You've never just been chopping vegetables in the kitchen and you're looking at your hand, it's like, I could chop through the whole thing.
I've been chopping vegetables in the kitchen and thought, what if I sliced open my finger or chopped off the tip of my finger and how horrible that would be? Because I do know what would happen. I don't know, man. I got... My guesses are my guesses. That's all I got.
I'll give you a hint if you want to get...
Oh, yeah, yeah. Let's do a hint.
So I have read this article. The hint is really in the word fraud. So...
Well, like I said, she has a fraudulent fake hand now. That's your hint?
My hint is fraud.
Oh, come on. That's not really... I see the word fraud. I just don't see how it could connect to her chopping off her hand.
Okay.
She didn't really saw off her hand. That's the fraud. She's like a David Blaine... Chris Angel mind freak magician type.
No, she did not make her hand disappear like a skyscraper. I think David Blaine made a skyscraper disappear.
Don't confuse cool David Blaine with David Copperfield, man.
They're the same person.
And actually, David Blaine is not cool, but his magic is cooler, I guess.
They both look like very manly Ann Coulters.
David Copperfield was... That was the thing in the 90s, was people couldn't believe he was married to Claudia Schiffer, the supermodel, because he's just kind of a normal-looking guy. But
I mean...
He's a rich magician.
A magician being married is kind of... it's a thing.
It's a thing, for sure.
It's a thing. Plenty of magicians have been married. Was Houdini married? I don't know, but maybe.
just hit a weird point in this episode. Magicians have been known to be married. Groundbreaking news.
It's surprising. I mean, yeah. Magic kids are a bit like...
You know, a lot of people shit on magicians. I mean, some of them are total douchebags, but have you seen that show on Netflix, Magic for Humans?
No, I haven't. I wanted to check it out.
It's actually good.
I won't lie, when the coronavirus stuff first started and, you know, I had a lot of free time, I have a lot of playing card decks at home, and I started watching card tricks online and I was trying to teach myself, like, card juggling and, like, card fingering and stuff, where you, like, basically shuffle cards from one hand to another or behind your back and you catch them and...
So those kind of just tricks, but not actual like the pick a card, any card type stuff.
Yeah, I was trying to learn more of the dexterous tricks, but it turns out that I am not very coordinated and never have been. And Also, I don't stick with tasks long enough to get good at them. So it's like, yeah, this isn't a hobby I'm going to take up for long.
I do believe that, you know, however anyone wants to sort of shit on the profession of magician, it does seem to take a fair amount of time and effort and skill to, like, get a lot of those basic skills down. But anyway, that show's fun. It's like a very light, like, if you're ever feeling depressed, I don't know, I would maybe, or not depressed, but just blue. Maybe.
Never happened. I've never once felt depressed about anything happening in the world.
All right, well, just in case, I don't know. I thought that show was all right.
Wait,
tell me what really happened.
Okay, so it looks like this woman was found guilty of deliberately sawing off her own hand as part of an insurance scam.
There we go.
So, like, she took out a big insurance policy that would have payouts up to $1.6 million, and she wanted that payout enough to cut off her own hand. And honestly, I've been there. I haven't went as far as to try to scam my insurance company, but I've thought about it. I've thought, you know, just taking a little tumble here or there might not be so bad. What's a hand? What's living stress-free with $1 million?
Oh, man, the first image on this is a fucking circular saw just, yeah, like, slicing through a 2x4.
I think that's what she used.
It says that's what she used. Or prosecutors said that's what she used. Slovenian. She's Slovenian. Where did this happen?
Well, they're showing the money in...
I think this is our only article not to come
from
CNN.
This is from the BBC,
yeah.
So I'm pretty sure it's England. Let's say England. We can confirm.
It's just under their Europe section, but I don't see them saying exactly where it is. It doesn't matter.
But, I mean, this just goes to show that the world's in a place where people are like, well, the only way I can fucking survive is cutting off my own hand.
Yeah, that's fucked up.
Yeah, I mean, people don't do this type of shit if there's good, like, protections for the lower class.
Okay, this is definitely in Slovenia.
Which I know very little about.
Yeah, me too. Do you think you can even pronounce the capital name? It's right there in the first sentence. I could not pronounce that. L-J-U-B...
Ljubljana. We're going to pretend...
That's a better guess than I would have made.
I'm going to pretend that the J's are like L's. So, Ljubljana.
Okay. Oh, man, she was only 22. For some reason, I was picturing, like, a really old lady. Oh,
22.
Man, that's even more fucked up somehow. I don't know why.
It is.
I
feel bad for her.
Well, yeah. She's not the villain of this story at all. I mean, I don't think so. Hang on, I'm going to read this. The court found that she and her boyfriend had intentionally left the severed hand behind rather than bringing it with them to ensure the disability was permanent. So they're like criticizing them for... I don't know, whatever. I think it's also very hard to sew back on a severed limb, like completely severed limb.
Sure, and I mean... I guess she did this as a scam, but honestly, this shows, like, some major, like, mental health problems that also probably need to be worked out.
Oh, yeah. I mean, people get desperate, but, like, sawing off your own hand, if that's, like, your first plan, yeah, something else is going on.
Yeah, this whole thing has me down.
Yeah, it's kind of a bummer. Is that the one we're ending on?
I mean, we could do one more if you want to. We're not.
But we've done the six, right? We've done the six in the chamber. Yeah, well, we got a bunch of other ones listed here. Why don't we just, like, go through and, like, pick out some interesting ones just to talk about?
We could just tell everyone what our options were.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Let's do a quick rundown of all the options, but no more than 5 seconds on each. Just real quick. Not even looking at the article.
Well, I think there's a couple in particular that I would want to just, like, take a more than 5 second look at, but
all right.
Well, some of them I haven't even read.
Oh, yeah,
Okay, why don't we just do every other one? I'll start with the robot dogs. Could they be part of U.S. military's kill chain? Next.
A multi-billion dollar shopping obsession goes mainstream in China.
Oh, you skipped the shocking moment. A passenger takes a walk on an airplane wing. Oh. I read that one. It was actually more boring than you would expect, because, you know.
Is it a flying airplane?
I mean, that's what you want it to be in a way. But, like, no, it was just like, I think it was also an issue of mental illness. They were just like, it was one of those things where they were taxiing or like stuck on the runway for a really long time. And I think the lady probably just had like extreme anxiety, because she just said, like, she very, like, calmly, like, opened the emergency door and just kind of, like, took a casual stroll. Like, there's a video of it on the wing. And this was somewhere in Europe as well. I think if it had been America, she would have been shot or something. But,
likely.
And I think they banned her for life from ever using that airline again. But they, like, they were just like, get back in the plane. And they, like, you know, took her inside.
It doesn't and seem like the biggest deal to me, but I guess it does like delay everything for everyone else.
Yeah, and it also shows, like, if you're willing to just like open the emergency door in an airplane, whether it's on the ground or not, like, you probably maybe shouldn't be on the flight. People aren't gonna feel safe after that. But she said, like, very calmly something just like, she said she was like feeling too hot on the airplane. So I think
them hot sometimes.
But I think it was probably just, yeah, it was like a claustrophobia, like, anxiety thing, probably. What's the next one after?
Lavender sales are soaring due to COVID-19. Here's why.
I don't, that one really, I have no idea what it is.
It just smells good. I mean, it does.
I know, but what does it have to do with COVID?
Lavender smells good. COVID-19 does not.
COVID smells bad?
I assume so. That's how you know not to go places. Like, oh, that place smells bad. There's probably coronavirus there.
Oh, that one's just a video, too. I'm not watching a fucking video. Not now. Videos. Maybe later.
We podcast because we hate videos.
Even though two of our episodes were just us watching videos.
For now.
After that is world's slowest musical composition changes chord. This one's a little interesting to take a quick look at. I did read this one. It's also this sort of like very pretentious art project, but it's just kind of interesting that it exists. Oh, it's a John Cage thing. Of course it is. You know John Cage, right?
Not really.
Okay. There's like his most famous thing is he composed a piece called 4 Minutes 33 Seconds, I think it was called.
I'm familiar with that title.
And it's just silence. Or what it's supposed to be is the ambient sounds of like the live audience. That's the composition. So that kind of pretentious shit. And yeah, he's making what is going to be the world's longest and slowest piece of music. It's meant to last 639 years, and it's called As Slow as Possible. And it began 19 years ago with a pause lasting nearly 18 months. The change of the chord took place on the specially built organ in which the composition is being performed. So it's like they just have this kind of like automated organ thing that's like playing the chords. And this is the first time any chord has changed. Well, in 7 years. I guess it's been going for 19.
I'm just not sure how to feel when I don't see a person in an emotional landscape painting. Well, wait, wrong medium. But I mean,
they kind
19
of
19 years for a note to change.
It kind of applies. I mean, like the character's thing about the abstract art kind of applies to this as well, for sure. I just think it's funny. It says the piece will end in the year 2640.
I am.
Oh wait, and John Cage died in 1992. But he wrote the piece in the 80s, so I guess someone is just like carrying out his wishes here. Okay, what's after that? Or do you got add anything to that one?
No, I have nothing to add there.
Okay, do you see the next one?
Joe Biden and VP Pence coming together.
Sexy.
That is a horror show.
All that one is about.
You don't need to explain. Everyone knows what coming together means.
Yeah, simultaneous orgasms, right?
I suppose so. They're similar heights.
No, it's them, well, oh, this is even dirtier, though. Coming together at the 9/11 memorial in New York City. They're like, just, that seems disrespectful to me, don't you think? No, all it is a fucking dumb story, which, oh my God. It's just the picture of them, like, doing the elbow tap instead of the handshake outside of this memorial where nobody is really truly social distancing anyway, but whatever. Yeah, they're at ground zero. I think what I don't like about this is that it's supposed to be this feel-good story for, like, and not for people that like Pence, but it's for people that like Biden. It's like, look at how open he is to the people across the aisle.
We can all work together to make our country great again.
What it reminded me of, though, is when, remember in like 2015, 2016, like during the ramp up to that, like people kept, like, I guess people on the left kept posting the picture of Donald Trump with Bill and Hillary Clinton, like, at a wedding or whatever the fuck it was.
Yeah.
And, like, looking very chummy. That's what this picture is to me, in a way. It's just like, yeah, we're kind of secretly all, we all want the same shit.
Yeah, they've all been working
together. We're dropping the facade for a second here. But it's meant for us to think of it as this feel-good story. And it doesn't make me feel good, I'll tell you that. All right. Next is talking robots could be used to combat loneliness. This one also...
Is this about the Japanese robots that they've built to like hang out with people?
I don't remember if it was Japanese in particular, but there's a good chance that it is. Talking robots could be used to combat loneliness and boost mental health in care homes. So it's targeted specifically at people in like nursing care homes, nursing homes, old people. I'm of two minds on this phenomenon, right? Like, if it is actually helping people to feel less depressed and less lonely, then I think it's good, obviously. But my gut reaction is like, this is fucked up and sad.
Sure.
What do you think?
I think it's a little sad, but not fucked up. I don't know.
Because it's... I'm actually all for, like, replacing certain jobs with robots. But jobs like this, no. Like, there are real human beings who are empathetic and compassionate, and they're like, they're built for this kind of work. Like,
sure.
That people who enjoy like these jobs that maybe like other people wouldn't be cut out for. And like, it's like, just give humans those jobs. Why? Like, I'm sure there's not a shortage of people that would. I'm sure the jobs just don't pay.
Those jobs pay so little.
Yeah, they don't pay well. And but if so, that's what I'm saying is like, incentivize the jobs, like boost the pay, and you'll get people who actually care for these people, and you won't have like all the weird abuses that happen in nursing homes as well. You know.
True.
But it just looked like this picture of this old man smiling at this robot. It just kind of, my initial reaction is it weirds me out. The other thing that weirds me out is that the company that is behind all this is called Caresses for some reason. I don't know why. I went to their website and it seems like kind of normal, but the study was known as Caresses, jointly funded by the EU and the Japanese government. And yeah, it's an AI system that can, like, sort of interesting thing is that they're designed to be, quote, culturally competent, meaning they can respond to culture-specific needs and preferences of older people, which is kind of interesting, I guess. But I don't know. Ultimately, I feel like build robots for other shit than this and just make the human jobs for this kind of thing more worthwhile. Like, that goes for, like, sort of, like, social work in general. Like, those jobs all pay shit. And those people deserve way more. I mean, I would say the same thing about teachers as well, you know? Like, you know how, like, in, like, Finland, like, elementary school teachers make, like, six figures?
I've heard that.
Yeah.
I mean, they get paid really well here in Korea, like, official, like, teachers.
Yeah. Most, I think around the world, that's kind of the trend. But anyway, we can go on to the next one. Unless you want to say something about these weird AIs.
No, I'm done with the AIs, to be honest.
Next one looks pretty weird, too.
I lost my place. These living clothes can absorb carbon emissions. That's actually really cool if it's true.
Clothes that absorb carbon emissions. I glanced at this one before because this was one that you were going to possibly take on. But I think it's a little less green-minded, or in a truly effective way than you might hope for. Canadian-Iranian designer Roya Agahi wants you to imagine your shirt is alive. Far from dreaming up a horror movie script, he hopes we can develop a more intimate relationship with fashion by treating clothes as living beings that need our help to survive. You're not going to throw your clothes in the corner of your closet or into the washing machine, she said over the phone from Vancouver. It's immediately going to shift the way you think about your clothing. Okay, and like the science of it basically is it's made from algae, which is supposed to purify the air around you. And I think the effect is probably so minuscule that it's like...
algae is such a giant market right now, with like algae fuels and algae health products. Like, they make protein powders out of it. Now they're making clothes out of it.
I didn't realize that. It just makes me far from inspiring me and thinking that the way that I think the writers of this article want it to, it just actually makes me realize how futile the fight against climate disaster might be.
A lot of people think the only way we'll beat climate disaster is if corporations and entrepreneurs figure out a way to make a profit from fighting climate disaster.
Which, as of now, I mean, they could.
They potentially will make a bigger profit, though, if they wait for the disaster to be very real and very present.
That's the thing, is like there's still plenty of fossil fuels left in the earth to exploit. So, in any case, Yeah, and the picture of this clothing, it looks fucking stupid. It looks really dumb. It's just like a, it looks like a tarp, like a clear tarp that someone has fashioned into the shape of a shirt. So it's also like this pretentious high fashion shit, and it just doesn't probably affect anything like in a significant way. Even if I imagine, even if every like living human being on Earth wore these things, it wouldn't make a dent in the problem. But that's just my cynical hunch. Let's see, what have we got left? We got a few things left. NASA wants to buy moon rocks.
They didn't get enough in the 70s. They need more.
I don't understand this.
What is there to understand? They want to buy moon rocks.
From who?
from the moon people.
Who has moon rocks?
The moon people.
Who has this great stash of rocks from the moon? Like in the private or the like outside of NASA scientists.
In the private sector. I do remember hearing something about after the initial moon missions that the moon rocks that were brought back at some point, they became like collector's items. They'd be sent out to people and or like sold privately between like astronauts and NASA employees too, like private individuals. Maybe NASA suddenly has a reason to want them back.
Yeah, it looks like they're willing to buy them back. And, yeah, this is all, I mean, the only, like, big takeaway from this is NASA is desperately trying to become, like, a commercialized, like, profitable company. Because, you know, their federal funding has been slashed quite a bit, and, yeah, I don't know. I guess I don't have much to say about that one. Other than I just thought it was weird that they're like, it just seems desperate to me.
It does.
They're like, please give us our moon rocks back.
We can't go to the moon anymore. Oh, can we just get the ones we used to have back?
Didn't you hear Trump at the RNC, man? He's
going to
put
going to Mars.
He also said he's going to put the first woman on the moon.
I'm surprised he hasn't already.
He said that in the same breath about... He said we're gonna plant an American flag on Mars and we're gonna put the first woman on the moon. All right, next one.
Who's gonna build a wall to the moon? And Mexico is gonna pay for it.
A wall to the moon.
You know, China has the Great Wall. America will have the moon wall.
What's the next one?
QAnon fans spread fake claims about real fires. I can only imagine that they're saying the fires are made by
George Soros.
The same evil people who sell children and eat pizza and
the adrenochrome set.
Those are the ones. Fuck whatever QAnon has to say.
You're probably close. It's the full headline is QAnon fans spread fake claims about real fires in Oregon. So this is in Oregon where things are burning quite quickly. I saw the rate that forest was burning because of these wildfires. It was mind blowing. Yeah. I can't recall exactly what it was now, but it was like, oh my God, I was shocked when I saw it.
I mean, the pictures look insane.
But it was like, I almost want to say like 100 acres per 30 seconds or something insane like that.
So, can you explain something to me? I haven't done my due diligence on the wildfires, but I do know that a meme is circulating that it was all because of a gender reveal party.
Oh, really? That started it? The thing that I saw about anything related to a gender reveal party was just that the woman who, like, first popularized gender reveal parties, like, went publicly said, I think people should stop doing the ones with explosions and fireworks. At least during these fiery times.
Okay. So maybe QAnon is the one who spread the claims that all this was due to a gender reveal party.
I don't think that's in this article.
Doesn't seem like they're like opus, though.
I mean, this is actually even more predictable, I guess, in a way. They're just saying it was Antifa. Antifa. I still haven't settled on which way to say that name. Antifa.
Anti-fascist.
Antifa.
The anti-fascist.
Antifada.
Like those guys. I think I consider myself a member.
Sounds like that's all you really need to become a member, since there's no real like organization as far as I know. But
I'm gonna start the Antifa Union. It's time for Antifa worker rights.
You might get deported here, man. They're not too keen on actual organized.
I thought Korea had really great work unions.
I was gonna say commoners. Maybe they do, but I'm saying Antifa is like anarchist or communist at least, and depending on who you ask, that identifies with it. But yeah, that's all they're really saying is just like they just made these false claims that Antifa did it, and the FBI responded by surprisingly saying these reports are not true.
Excellent.
I'm
surprised the FBI had time considering all the jetpacks they have to go and, find.
They also falsely claimed that the Oregon, whatever county sheriff's office had 6 Antifa arsonists in custody. It's just completely made up. Like everything they say. Here's a more depressing thing.
New York man.
Wow, some of these Q people. I haven't looked a lot into this Q phenomenon, but you're right. You said before, like, a lot of people are taking it super seriously. Some, I guess, anonymous guy said, I don't think you can discount Q more than you can discount anybody.
Oh, people have eaten the Kool-Aid of QAnon. People believe it.
And it looks like a lot of this is all happening on 8chan.
Yes, the spinoff of 4chan, an even worse, seedier place on the internet.
In 2019, 8chan was linked to 3 atrocities, including the shooting in El Paso that left 23 people dead. And they're going to lecture us about the dastardly Antifa. All right. Oh, I never gave you your last one, man.
Oh no, let's do that one. Then
yeah,
let's,
yeah.
Then let's call it quits after we do this one because I think it's good.
Okay.
I think it's a good place to end. The headline roulette.
There was one
clickbait roulette.
There was one more about a guy who faked his death to avoid jail, but a typo is what got him caught.
Sucks.
And it was a really, really dumb typo. I think he spelled registry like registry or something. Anyway, okay, here we go, Jason. This one's all for you to figure out. Virginia man gets permission to be buried in juicy fruit themed casket. What on earth?
I can, I understand.
Do you?
Yeah, I mean, this man, he wants to be buried in a juicy fruit-themed casket. And his plan is, he's into, like, the ideal of being in a claustrophobic space. He loves eating. He has this claustrophobic kink. And what better than to be buried in, like, juicy fruit and to eat your way out of being buried. Because I imagine the casket's made out of juicy fruit, then all the way up it's just like syrupy, gummy, jelly, candy that he'll just have to swim and eat his way through and slowly eats his way to the ground.
So you're thinking he's preparing for, like, a false burial like used to happen back in the day?
I do. I think this is, like, this man's, like, wildest, like, yeah, juicy fruit. I can't wait to eat, like, 8 feet of juicy fruit.
All right. Shall we unmask the headline?
Let's investigate.
94-year-old Virginia man with a lifelong love of juicy fruit has received permission from the Mars Wrigley Company to have his casket painted to resemble a pack of the chewing gum. Sammy Oki, president of Oki's funeral service, was asked by friend Sutty Economy. This is the person's real last name. It's spelled exactly like the word economy. Also 94 years old. Oh, wait, no, this is the guy, Sutty Economy. He's the one who wants to be buried in the juicy fruit casket. So he asked the funeral service if they would, funeral home service, whatever, if they would do it. Economy, who was hospitalized due to a heart condition 3 weeks ago, is currently being treated at the Virginia Veterans Care Clinic, where his condition was reported to be improving. I never heard this word before. The nonagenarian, I guess, 90-year-old. I don't know if I'm saying that right, but anyway. Developed a love for Wrigley's chewing gum while serving in World War II. When the company took juicy fruit and other varieties of gum off the market so there would be enough to distribute to U.S. service members. See, these were back in the days when we really supported the troops, man.
Paid them in bubble gum.
Didn't throw them in jail for 5 years for bullshit.
Paid them in bubble gum.
And we also paid them in bubble gum.
Greatest generation. They knew how to chew.
Oh, man. They also gave him so many cigarettes. Oh, those were the days. Okay. He brought his love of juicy fruit home with him, friends and family said. Sutty would come home in here for visitation or just come in to visit, and he would always bring a bunch of packs of juicy fruit chewing gum. Put it out for the employees to enjoy, Oki told CNN. He didn't just do that here. He did it at restaurants and doctor's offices wherever he went. So he was like the Johnny Appleseed of juicy fruit, just distributing around his city. I'm almost done. I kind of want to just read the whole thing.
Imagine if someone did this for our podcast.
What?
You know, just sat recordings of it around for people to listen to.
Are you subtly hinting to anyone who's maybe listening?
It's a bit of a dream of mine.
To pass around our podcast.
Why not?
Yeah.
Be like Sutty.
Be like Sutty, be like Johnny Appleseed.
And you don't even have to ask for permission to have a casket made with a Heat Death of the Universe logo.
Yeah, you got it. It's already done.
Anyone who wants one can have one. If we have any 94-year-old listeners.
And I mean, the real Heat Death of the Universe is going to, you know, well, no, not really. But, the sun will swallow it up anyway. So that's kind of like being endorsed. Anyway. Okay, here's where it gets a little sad, in my opinion, or a little fucking weird. Oki, who's been friends with Economy family for 45 years, said he determined that he would need permission from the Mars Wrigley Company to use the juicy fruit imagery on a casket. Doesn't it strike you as fucked up that something that's going to be buried in the ground, these corporate entities are still going to, like, threaten, like, litigation over if they don't get, like, explicit permission? This old man wants to paint a symbol on his casket, and, like, they had to ask this company for permission. Like, I'll put a fucking picture of juicy fruit up on a goddamn episode right now, and I'm not going to ask them permission, and that's not even being buried in the earth.
We're not going to advertise juicy fruit.
I know, I'm just saying I could. Although I guess technically they probably could sue us as well, but anyway, I thought that was fucked up. The company, and here's the more fucked up part. The company initially refused the request, this dying request, basically, of a 94-year-old man who's been, like, not just enjoying their product for his whole life, but like giving them free advertising and passing it around.
Yeah, exactly.
And then here's how they finally gave permission. A bunch of old people had to like make a big petition on Facebook. The post went viral, and a member of the public was able to get Oki contact information for the company's president. They had to go all the way to the fucking president of the Mars Wrigley Company, and then they gave permission because they're like, "Oh shit, we're starting to look bad on Facebook." And then look how kind this company is. The family received 250 packs of Juicy Fruit gum.
Nice.
Economy's brother John said the family is now seeing an artist to paint the casket. The end.
250 packs isn't even that much.
I know, I'm saying it's a fucking stupid gesture.
It is.
I just can't believe they refused it to begin with. That's so shitty.
A little bit.
It's just so petty. Like, I don't understand. Not that like anyone's hurt really, except the old man's feelings maybe, but like, anyway.
A casket is a luxury I can't afford.
Just throw me in the Han River.
I just want the sun to eat me up.
You're going to have a green burial, like whatever those are called. Well, on that note, right?
On that note.
Should we move on to the second part?
Let's move on to... you know, the things that we think are cool.
I'm going to refill my cup and empty my bladder.
I think I might do that as well.
Nice. Let's provide some general recommendations. I'll go first. I actually had this one set aside in my kind of list of potential general recommendations, and but there was a part of what we talked about earlier that reminded me of this particular film. We mentioned that article about the living clothes that are supposed to be good for the environment and purify the air made out of algae. And that idea of imagine your shirt is a living being reminded me of this film called In Fabric. It's a 2018 movie, British film. Written and directed by a guy named Peter Strickland. And the central conceit of the movie is that there is this red dress that is seemingly sort of sentient, and it kind of is like the villain in a slasher film.
Okay.
Which sounds like it sounds like a B movie, you know? It sounds like a silly, self-conscious, like horror movie, but it's actually way more, I think, sophisticated than that. This guy, Peter Strickland, his previous, like, I think two movies before this were also really interesting. He tends to do surreal stuff. This is a through line with any of my recommendations. I like weird stuff. And, yeah, this movie was surprisingly good, actually. Just on a stylistic level, it looks different from a lot of movies that are coming out in this era. Like, I think it was purposely shot on, like, older film stock. It looks almost more like it's from the 80s or the 70s.
When did it come out?
2018.
Okay.
And it actually had, like, a pretty good amount of success. It was also distributed by A24, which is, you know, the cool, hip film company that I tend to like most of their movies. So I watched it. I really liked it. It's It's actually billed here as a horror comedy. It is very funny in a weird way. I watched it and I liked it so much that I went back and I watched the director's two previous movies, which were also quite good and strange in their own ways. I was going to just explain his other movies, but I should leave that for another time. One of his previous movies was scored by the band Broadcast, which was a previous recommendation of mine. It was, I think, the last thing they ever did as a band. But yeah, I don't want to say too much about the plot, but just check out In Fabric. Jason, what do you got?
So my nice thing this week? Yeah, I don't know if it's this week or not. But I like kind of I like fantasy books. Just mindless. You don't have to think about it much. And I've been reading these books by Robin Hobb, who is famous for her trilogy of books called the... I forgot its name. I'm reading the book right now called The Lifeship Traders, which I like a lot. It's about pirates. It's pretty good. Robin Hobb is actually a really excellent female fantasy writer. She's done some press interviews with George R. R. Martin, who you probably know from Game of Thrones, and she's a much better writer than George R. R. Martin, and I feel like often women fantasy writers are not as seen as male fantasy writers.
Well, maybe not taken as seriously. Or taken as seriously, by that, but the demographic.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And she writes some of the best, I want to say hard fantasy. But not grimdark. It's not grimdark like A Song of Ice and Fire or Game of Thrones, whatever you want to call it. But it is very real, and she explores really neat ideals within the confines of being the fantasy genre. And I'm really enjoying it right now.
Cool. I'm not as familiar with the genres of science fiction and fantasy as you, but I definitely know of hard sci-fi, which in theory appeals more to me. And I've read a little bit of it, but not much. But the idea of hard fantasy, I wonder what that would even look like.
What I mean by hard fantasy is I think the most glaring example or biggest example is Game of Thrones, which is fantasy, but it's also very much just set in reality. Characters die. It's not the general hero's journey. It's more of politics can be fucked up, etc., etc. And she kind of writes in the same vein as George R. R. Martin.
Okay,
but I think that the stuff that she does is better.
It has it has an element of historical realism to even though it's set, say, on another planet or something.
Exactly.
Okay, cool.
Maybe it has some fantasy races or whatever. But
is there less just outright magic involved?
Yeah, there's less outright magic, and I want to say there's less clearly defined good versus evil going on.
Okay.
More grayness to the characters, more just people exist. People do fucked up shit sometimes because they need to do it to survive, or maybe they do it because they don't personally think it's fucked up, and it's very just... There aren't say you take Lord of the Rings, or you have the Fellowship, and they're all clearly the good guys and they're fighting Sauron, and it's not that. It's more of just people existing in this world under the rules of that world. And I like what she writes, and this book's old. I've been meaning to get to it forever, but because I'd read The King's Assassin. I think that's what her famous book series is called. I was having a hard time pulling the name out of my head a minute ago. A long time ago, and really liked it, and always meant to get around to reading her other stuff because she's written a lot. And I picked it up the other day. And I was like, oh, because I was looking for something lighter to read because I'd been reading other stuff. And I was like, I just want to read generic fantasy. And I wouldn't even call her generic fantasy, as most people think of generic fantasy. But I recommend checking her out if you haven't heard of her.
Cool. Sounds good. So that's where we think about of ending things.
Yeah, let's end things. So long, farewell, sayonara, motherfuckers.
Auf Wiedersehen, goodbye.
Hey, what you say is true. The Shaolin and the Wu-Tang could be dangerous. Do you think your Wu-Tang sword can defeat me?
On guard. I'll let you try my Wu-Tang style.
Bring the motherfucking ruckus! Bring the motherfucking ruckus! Bring the motherfucking ruckus! Bring the motherfucking ruckus!
Ghost face, catch the blast of a hype verse. My clock burst, leaving a hearse. I did worse, I come rough, tough like an elephant tusk. Your head rush, fly like Egyptian musk. Aw, shit, Wu-Tang Clan sparked the Wixen. However, I mastered a trick just like Nixon. Causing terror, quick damage, your whole era. Hard rocks is like the fuck up, I found shot. PLO style, hazardous, cause I wrecked this dangerous. I blow spots like Waco, Texas.
I watch my back like I'm locked down. Hardcore hitting sound, watch me act bulk and tear down. Illiterate type asshole, songs going gold, no doubt. And you watch your corny nigga phone. Yeah, they faking all that. Carrying cats, but your mind plan rolling like 40 max. Now you act convinced, I guess it makes sense. Wu-Tang, yo, soul represent. I wait for one to act up, now I got him backed up. Gun to his neck now, react what? And that's one in the chamber. Wu-Tang banger, 36 styles of danger.
Bring the motherfucking ruckus. Bring the motherfucking ruckus.
Straight out the swamp, creeping up on.